Well, hello again, and welcome to the Harris Lecture Studio once again. This time my background is the Round Reading Room that's part of the British Library and British Museum. It's a pretty cool space, and the distortion here is not quite what I'd like. Today we're going to be looking at 19th century politics and what I like to call the isms. We're going to be looking at kind of the isms and their growth and the ideas of the 19th century, not specific political legislation for the most part. That will occur only kind of as we're talking about these grand ideas that appear in the 19th century and are going to have a very long life. Right here, you see my favorite map, one of my favorite maps of all time. I love this map that has all of the countries of Europe and tries to give them their characteristics as they were in 1870. By 1870, Italy has appeared on the screen. Yay, Italy! We are once again, viva l'Italia, is now on the screen again. You can see France. Looking like they're going to whack Prussia, which is slowly expanding and waking up and pushing into Austria. And Norway looking over there suspicious, well, proud Denmark over here with nose now. Belgium, which looks like it's about to be squished between like some sort of, I don't know, jello between France and Prussia. Prussia has not quite yet become Germany. That's part of the printed lecture that's online. Spain looks like it's asleep, and Portugal's a trained monkey, and Britain is an old fussy lady who has a trained bear on the leash, Ireland, which is about to attack her at any moment. And there's Turkey being indolent down there, smoking a hookah. I love this map. It's a lot of fun. And it shows you kind of how the Europeans thought of one another in the 19th century. As we go into the 19th century, this is sometimes referred to as the Victorian era. Victoria is on the throne for a majority of the century, but it does beg the question of what do we call the 19th century, and where does it begin and where does it end? Now, mathematically speaking, usually that's 1800 and 1900. Some of the mathematicians are going to quibble and say it's 1801 to 1900, and I'm not going to do that. Because really, that mathematical definition doesn't work for historians. It's rather irrelevant for us. It doesn't really help us understand the period at all, because 1800 is in the middle of the Napoleonic Wars. The next war starts in 1914. There's not much happening in 1900 that makes that year significant, okay? Whereas with the early modern period, we ran it from 1648 to 1815, okay? So we have a chunk here. It's actually about a century and a half, but it works. It actually makes more sense in historical time frame. Now, Victoria gets used, and there she is. I'll move my picture so you can see her, because she is on the throne the majority of the century. But the reality is that 1837 to 1901 doesn't have any more significance than 1800 to 1900, except in the length of Victoria's reign. She's the second longest reigning British monarch, just behind her, the current queen, Queen Elizabeth II. Victoria's, I think, triple great-granddaughter. At any rate, the one that most historians tend to work with is 1815 to 1914, because 1815, end of the Napoleonic Wars, 1914, beginning of World War I. It works as a nice, clean bookend. And the things that are inside of that front time frame actually fit together as a whole much better. And that's important, too. Now, there are some historians who would prefer to break this at 1870, simply because we're going to see very shortly the formation of Germany at that point. And we're also going to see a number of other changes in 1870 technologically. And really, that's the point of a lot of a European expansion in terms of imperialism. We're going to stick with 1814 to 1914. I think I said that backwards. The characteristics of this period are going to be dominated by the concept of change. There's a lot of changes in the 19th century. If you took somebody from 1914 and plopped them down in 2020, they'd have some trouble adjusting. But they would recognize things like the cars and electricity and phones. Now, not necessarily computers. This is one of the reasons steampunk is so popular. Let's go back to the 19th century. Let's pull some technology and let's jazz it up a bit, because there's a lot of funky technology going on in the 19th century. There are things in the 19th century that are much more like us than they were the 17th century. There just is this big shift. And probably the biggest piece of that is in terms of the Industrial Revolution. We're going to see them in the same time frame go from sailing ships with sails to diesel fuel by the end of the century. We're going to go from stagecoaches to steam engines. And then we're going to shift to coal. We're going to shift from coal to eventually diesel. We're going to go from lamps that light the streets that are candle-based to gas, and then to electricity by the time we're heading into the 20th century. So there's lots and lots of changes. Electrical lights are going to see their first big push at the World's Fair, the Exposition Universelle, in 1889 in Paris. Okay, so lots and lots of different pieces here. And all of this is going to transform daily life, but it's also going to transform politics and international economies and how countries relate to one another. But there's also going to be other things that are part of that. One of those things that transforms the international economy are things like this. This is the Suez Canal, which will be built in 1869. We'll see the Panama Canal begin to be built in 1911. And both of those are going to seriously reduce the amount of time it takes to get anywhere in our globe. No longer do you have to take 2 or 3 months to go around the horn of, go to around Africa or the around South America. You just cut through. And all of a sudden, that changes dramatically trade patterns and the speed of life. There are also a lot of other revolutions and change, some of which we'll refer to. You've got a separate lecture on that's printed on German and Italian unification theories, and I'm not going to spend time on that here. But I do want you to see the modern political map. Now, some of this comes as the result of the Congress of Vienna, where we're going to see the rearranging of borders, the Holy Roman Empire is for gone for once and for all, but there are going to be a lot of other movements. You'll notice on this map, there's no Belgium, there's no Greece. But on this map, there is. Well, that's because Greece breaks away from the Ottomans in 1823. Belgium becomes independent in 1830, which I did not put that date on this map. You'll also see up here, Russia is going to be becoming more and more of an issue. You see the German Empire formed in 1870, 1871, which stretches all the way into was once just Prussia and encompasses parts of Poland. The Austro-Hungarian Empire shifting from the Holy Roman Empire or just Austria into the Austro-Hungarian Empire in 1867. Once again, that's discussed in the German unification lecture. And multiple revolutions still in France. Their final one will be the formation of the Third Republic in 1870. So it's a busy period. But we're also going to see new political isms coming onto the forefront, new ideologies. Now, an ism can be known as a secular creed. And let me say that again, a secular creed, which means that these ideas are not about religion, but they can be followed with religious-like devotion. If you ever meet a sincere Marxist, they believe that with the same fervor that a devout Christian believes in God, okay? It's the same belief manifestation, and we'll see this in a lots of different places as we go. And then, Mal, the most dominant here are conservatism and liberalism. Those are the two dominant ideologies of the period. John Stuart Mill that you see here is going to become the kind of quintessential expression of liberalism. In fact, my Western political thought class this semester is in fact still reading him, but we'll also see other kinds of cultural phenomena, romanticism and nationalism, which are sometimes very much linked together and sometimes very separate. Guys like Beethoven, who become one of the key pieces of the Romantic movement. And you had some of his pieces to listen to last week with romanticism. But there were also seeds of the future. And I think I went too far. With new ideologies appearing like socialism and Marxism and feminism by the end of the century, we'll see the term feminism coined in 1896, but it's certainly at work in some of the suffrage movements prior to 1896. We could also add in Darwinism. We could argue for positivism. We could argue for progressivism, social Darwinism. We got a lot of isms. Pick one. They often start here. Okay, let's go take a look at them. Politics in the 19th century is concerned with one of the questions that's raised out of the French Revolution. Okay, motto of the French Revolution, just a reminder, is liberty, fraternity, and equality. Now, the fraternity part's going to have to do with nationalism, and equality and liberty, these ideas of freedom and equality, are going to be tied together in this new rising ism of liberalism. Liberal reform. Now, by liberal reform, we mean liberty, freedom of individual expression. Now, understand, conservatism and liberalism in the 19th century do not mean what they mean in the 21st century. These are vastly different entities. The liberalism of the 19th century is not liberalism now. What we call liberal now is closer to socialism, okay? Liberalism here is a lot closer to pieces of conservatism now, or even the libertarians, and we'll see about that in a little bit. But the dominant ideology of the 19th century is conservatism. Now, conservatism has a couple of different forms. Now, one of these is what we call being a reactionary. Now, a reactionary means you want no change. No, 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 no. We have to have time travel back to the old order, put it all back together the way it was before the French Revolution. Now, that's not possible. The ideas of liberty, the ideas of fraternity, the ideas of equality are there. They're not going away. But the reactionaries actually really do want to take it back prior to the French Revolution, before these ideas were like Pandora's box and the things out of Pandora's box and everywhere. Now, one of the clear ideologues beyond who was a reactionary is going to be Clemens von Metternich. Now, Metternich is the foreign minister of Austria. He's going to be the dominant kind of international personality here. He's going to be heavily involved in diplomacy and even quelling revolutions. He's a dominant figure at the Congress of Vienna that winds up the Napoleonic Wars. And he really, really does not appreciate the idea of liberty at all. And quite frankly, the idea of equality, and particularly anything to do with nationalism, it's very, very dangerous to his homeland of Austria, which is a multinational empire, and the concept of nationalism will eventually destroy it. He's not wrong, okay? He's not wrong. He may be reactionary, but that doesn't mean that he is incorrect in recognizing the danger that nationalism poses to his current government. There are others who were going to try to create still a divine absolutism defense of the old order. This one doesn't get a lot of traction in the 19th century. The French Revolution has effectively killed it, except in Russia, and its time is coming. You also see conservatives for cautious change. You see some of this even in Russia. You certainly see it in Great Britain. Sometimes you see it in other places, even in Austria, okay? The father of conservative cautious change, is Edmund Burke. And we talked about Edmund Burke already. and my printed lecture notes on the French Revolution and elsewhere. But I want to make certain we understand, because Edmund Burke, what he's going to say is that change has to be rooted in something. This is the reason he's against the French Revolution, is because it's just not rooted in anything. And as a result, it's just going to implode. And it does. It turns into the Reign of Terror. He says, if you want to change, you need to change in connection with your root system, in connection with history and change and tradition, and so that that incremental change will create greater and greater liberty, but it will not do so at the expense of destroying society as we know it. Conservatism, this form of conservatism is not usually what we mean when we say conservatism now, although there are certainly people who still fall into this idea. Burke's ideas are the very reason why he's going to support the American Revolution, but not the French. American Revolution, he sees as connected with the changes and the ideas of liberty that are inherent in the parliamentary system in Britain. Liberal reformers, on the other hand, didn't really care about having things rooted in tradition or authority or slow change. Most of them wanted rapid change, change now, not a little bit later, not after we've thought about it and done it in a considered fashion, okay? That's gonna very much characterize most conservatives then and now. Instead, they wanted individualism. They wanted democracy. They wanted a laissez-faire government. Now, laissez-faire is a term from the French. It simply means hands-off. It means the government's going to stay out of it for the most part. And they wanted the government to largely stay out of their lives, to create as much individual liberty as possible, okay? As much liberty as possible. Kind of quintessential example of liberal ideas is going to be in the ideas of John Stuart Mill, who writes in On Liberty in 1867. Now, the ideas predate him, okay? He's just going to give us a nice theoretical statement of it. But it's the ideas that were floating around in Europe well before him, okay? And what he's going to say is the idea is that liberty is a key thing that everyone should have automatically, okay? And that any government is going to limit your freedom in some form. And so therefore you have to make certain you have as little government as possible so you can have as much individual freedom. He's not against government, okay? He just doesn't want the government to be big. Okay, so it's here, you hear small government ideas of today's conservatives. That's very much going to be in line with the 19th century liberals. The kind of quintessential idea is that government should do roads and foreign policy and not much else. They shouldn't get involved in economics. They shouldn't get involved in regulations for this kind of idea. The best example is usually something about a bike helmet. This is the kind of quintessential example. Is that a liberal is going to see that wearing a helmet when you're riding a motorcycle or riding a bike is a good idea. They don't think that there ought to be a law that makes you. They think you should be allowed to be as stupid as possible, okay? That this is something that is your decision, and if you want to go splatter your brains all over the pavement by not wearing a helmet, that's your choice, okay? Now, a modified position is going to be from the conservatives. If conservatives are going to have no problems passing a law that says, yes, you have to wear a helmet because you not wearing a helmet has an impact on us. Niagara Falls, the 19th century, there's a lot of people who go walking on wires across the falls and do all of these tricks about going over the falls in a barrel and all of these sorts of things. But one of the things... Hi, guys. James is here. Say hi.
Hi.
Oh, dear. Hi, guys. Somewhere in the middle of conservatives for costless change. Okay, Niagara Falls. There's now a law that makes it illegal to try and go over the falls in a barrel or to try and walk across the falls and or the Niagara River and Niagara Gorge. On a tightrope. And the reason that is because they get tired of the rescue workers having to risk their lives to go rescue these people who, and then they'd lose rescue workers trying to get this person out. And so that's why the law is there. And conservatives will have absolutely no problem passing that kind of law. But the liberals would have, okay? You'll see a lot of liberals in this period. You'll see the Whig Party in England is very much part of the liberal ideology. Guys like William Pitt, William Gladstone, who's going to be the great liberal prime minister of England during the 19th century. There's William Pitt. He's a rather young fellow. And he's going to be running the Napoleonic Wars, and he's also going to be helpful eventually in the anti-slavery campaigns in Britain. You'll also see liberal activists in Prussia and Austria and Italy and France. And there'll be student groups who are very liberal, ideal-minded in Germany. They're called the Burschaften. Welcome to German. And they would be agitating for reform within Prussia and eventually in Germany when it is Germany, but often between just the various Germanic principalities, you would see these guys be very, very prominent. But not everybody wanted to hear their ideas about liberal reform or various individualistic kinds of ideas. In fact, in 1819, Prussia is actually going to issue what is known as the Carlsbad Decrees, which forbid talking about nationalism and liberal ideas in university classrooms by both professors and by students. Okay. That leads to a lot of frustrations in some of these places. Now, you'll notice that I mentioned a minute ago that the conservatives would have had no problem passing that law about Niagara Falls. And in fact, one of the interesting things is while there were reformers on the liberal side of things who wanted greater democracy and greater things, but a lot of the things that we would consider social reforms, like regulating factories, the liberals won't do. That's the government meddling in economics, and they don't want that. So you're going to get reform in Britain, in fact, partly by the conservatives rather than, in fact, just the liberals. Now, the conservatives in Britain will be known by the political party, the Tories. The Duke of Wellington, who defeats Napoleon, will be one of the Tory leaders. Later on, it'll be Benjamin Disraeli. They'll pass the 1832 Reform Bill, which will reform the franchise, reform how, in fact, you're figuring out which districts need representation. England hadn't been redistricted since the 1400s. So it's been 400 years since they were redistricted when they passed this bill in 1832. By the way, this is the reason we have a census. We do this every 10 years. Because when we write our constitution in 1787, we already knew that it had been 300 some odd years since the English had last redistricted their parliament. And some of the districts were underwater, but still putting people in parliament. You're going to see a lot of change that comes because of that. And you're going to get new people who can be involved in the political process because of this. We'll see social and industrial reform in England, reforms that keep children out of factories that are passed first in 1819 and again in 1833. These will be passed by conservative regimes, not necessarily by liberal ones. Now, one of the more interesting ideologies that pops up in the 19th century is going to be a new one called socialism. And socialism is about the realities of, back that up, it's about the idea of society in politics, and it's considering what the role of society has in politics. And like the name socialism says, society is going to be more important than the individual liberty. That's liberalism. If you want individual liberty, that's liberalism. If you're talking about the good of society, we're talking about socialism. So we've got very, and conservatives have varying degrees. Hold on. For the socialist, happiness could only be achieved collectively. They were not adverse to concepts of freedom, okay? But they didn't see individualism as the way to create a society that was the best society. So that's one of the key pieces here. The first theorists of socialism were not Marxists. Marx is late, actually, for this. The first theorists are in between about 1817 and 1832. You get guys like Henri Saint-Simon, who's going to be writing in the late 18th century and in the early 19th. You get guys like Robert Owen, who's going to go try and found utopian communities, industrial communities with dormitories and housing and stuff so that he provides for all the needs of society. We get Louis Blanc in France at the same time. They're very critical of capitalism and the abuses of the Industrial Revolution. And a lot of what they're saying is correct about some of the abuses of the Industrial Revolution. There were no regulations, and so you have children as young as two working in factories. And that's why you're going to need those child labor laws. But those are going to be things that the liberals have a little more trouble voting for, even if they're not certain it's a good, they may think it's a good idea, but they're not certain that they want regulation about it. The conservatives who want slow change are like, we have the authority to make laws, we'll use it. Done. And so sometimes, oddly enough, in the 19th century, you're going to see these kind of coalitions of social reformers who will become socialists with the conservatives to pass legislation. Government for the socialists should provide some sort of protective net for society, a what we now call social security. That term is going to be initially used in the 19th century. It's going to be used for the net that's created in 1935 by FDR. They're going to have mixed ideas about private property. Some of them are going to be completely anti-private property. Many of them are not, but they want the means of production, things like factories and eventually utilities, to be owned socially, in other words, by the entire society, which usually means government shares. One of them is going to be important. I just showed you the fronts piece of is the Fabian Society. It was founded in Britain by Sidney and Beatrice Webb in the 1884. They were passionately nonviolent. They would not use violent means to try and overthrow. Now, that's not going to be true of all socialists, okay? But that particular society is going to agitate for legislative reform. And they're going to, in fact, get it. And we're going to see socialists who make their way into government. And eventually, the Labour Party in Britain, which will be formed by the early 20th century, within what we would, before 1914, we'll see the first Labour Party members who are socialist, really, in a lot of their ideology. Now, the one that doesn't really gain any traction is anarchism. Anarchism comes into being in about 1840, and it means that any government limits one freedom. Now, it's not a brand new idea. We can go back to Diogenes of Sinope, who decides to live like a dog in a barrel in the ancient Greece, and find anarchism, okay? And we can even go back further than that to some of Socrates' own disciples who advocated anarchism. But these guys are going to say that any government limits one's freedom beginning in the 1840s. Now, you have a handout on this because these guys are going to go after, use violence to try and overthrow governments. They're going to assassinate 12 separate world leaders, including being responsible for the assassination of U.S. President McKinley. They will assassinate a couple members of the Austrian royal family. They are a serious problem. However, they don't actually topple any governments. They'll bomb Wall Street in 1900. They'll start having meetings in 1907, which is really fascinating to me because these are anarchists who don't believe in governing, and they're going to have meetings in which they're going to govern themselves. It doesn't go very well. They will assassinate these world leaders, but they don't actually topple any governments. And your handout that's on anarchism on Canvas actually has a list of all the world leaders and a little bit more about some of their ideology. Now, probably the most important of these isms, other than socialism and feminism, is Marxism. And Marxism is going to have a decided impact on the 20th century, though it doesn't have much in the 19th century. Now, initially, it's a form of socialism, which is why sometimes for many Americans, they get the two of them confused and put socialism and communism together. And that's not quite what this is. Now, Karl Marx is going to be an author and a reporter of some note in the 19th century. He is going to be German in his affiliations, though there's not yet a Germany when he's born. His writing partner is this gentleman here. This is Frederick Engels. And together they're going to write a kind of a tour de force on their ideologies.
Which one of these antennas should I use?
This one.
Why? This one's a lot more shorter.
That's up to you. Antennas you want to be long and to go farther away. But, oh, well, you're putting it on a small robot. Okay, the smaller one then. Yes. I digress. This is why I tend to record in the middle of the night instead of during the day. Okay. Well, anyhow. Go on Canvas. There is a handout on Marx's stages of history. You're going to want that in just a second. So if you need to pause the video, now's a good spot. Now, we're back. Hopefully you have your handout because we're going to kind of walk through some things about Marx's theory. Marx is going to participate in the revolutions of 1848 and 1849, particularly the one in Cologne and one in Baden. These revolutions of 1848 and 1849 are kind of what the world does sometimes. The world sometimes seems to catch a cold, where we get revolution all over the world. We saw this in the middle of the 17th century, in the 1640s, where we get revolution in China, and we get revolution in Europe, revolutions all over Europe. We even get it in Mexico and South America and in Africa and even in the Middle East. It just kind of seems to be everywhere. Well, we get this in 1848, 1849 in Europe, but the trouble is all the armies stay loyal and they're not particularly well organized and they really don't go anywhere in 1840, 1849. And so Marx is very disillusioned because of the failures of these. And becomes disillusioned with democracy and sees capitalism and the wealth of the industrialists as the great problems that Germany faces. And he doesn't really see a solution to it, okay? Particularly not through any kind of legislative reform. And he comes up with his own theory of history. And he puts this forth in his book, The Communist Manifesto. He writes the Communist Manifesto in 1848, coming fresh off of these disasters that he's going through in terms of revolution. So what does he argue? And I'll uncover him here and move my picture up just a bit. There we go. There he is again. Great beard. Now, the first thing he argues for is what we call dialectical materialism. Now, dialectical materialism says that the only thing that matters is material. That there are no ideas that matter, which is really ironic because he's going to create a significant ideology all on his own. But he says that material is what matters, the stuff, and that there are arguments between people who have the stuff, which is going to drive his ideas of history, which we'll talk about in a second. He's going to be what we call an economic determinist. And anytime you've got a determinist, that means believe in single causation. Now, you remember I talked about earlier that single causation theory means somebody's selling you something. In this case, he's selling you his theory. But he doesn't think that theories matter. He thinks that only materials matter because he thinks he's not telling you a theory. Marx actually believes that this is how the world works. This is it. And there's nothing else. Okay. And he believes that economics are the only thing that matter. Okay. Nationalities don't matter, religion doesn't matter, none of that. It's all smoke screens. It's all about economics. Okay. That's all he thinks matters. Okay. Now, borrowing from this, he has his stages of history. Now, his stages of history are going to be how he believes history developed. Now, he sees this as fact. He's one of a number of guys running around in the 19th century who think they have found the one key to understanding how all of human history works. Okay. He's not the only one, but he's certainly going to become the most prominent of all of them. We're also going to get Auguste Comte, who's going to be kind of the founder of modern sociology, who is going to also think that he understands how all of human history has worked, and he has the key too. Now, he believes in what he calls the theory of increasing misery. And that what he means by that is that the lot of the working classes cannot ever get better by any sort of means other than revolution. That capitalism will never reform itself. Democracy is incapable of doing anything. It's useless, okay? In other words, he doesn't believe in legislatures. Now, you need to keep in mind, he comes from Germany. Germany, which in his day is not united, okay? And it's not going to be until the tail end of his lifetime, okay? And democracy in Germany is very, very limited. There's just not much of any of it at all. And while he's going to live in England for a long period of time, he never really takes part in or observes in the political process in England. And in fact, by 1848, the English have already legislated reforms about some of the worst abuses of industrialization, of his industrialism. Don't tell Marx. He believes that with the theory of increasing misery, that these things are going to just pull apart further and further and further apart. Okay. Until the working class has no choice but to revolt else. And he ends his great works with, "Working men of the world, unite. You have nothing to lose but your chains." Okay. He also doesn't believe in nationalism, which is really interesting because Germany is very, very full of nationalism. But part of it is because he sees the failures of 1848 and he just thinks national ideologies and national boundaries are irrelevant, which he's completely misreading his own day. Now, by the way, I have a separate handout that's up there about Marx's prophecies that failed. That's going to deal with more and more with theory of increasing misery and nationalism. To your handout, let's walk through his stages of history. Marx is going to borrow from a little bit from Socrates and a little bit from a fellow by the name of Hegel, who we'll talk about. And he's going to use what is called the Hegelian dialectic. And it's kind of the basis. We see this in our concept in our judicial system, that you have a thesis and an antithesis. And the Hegelian dialectic believes that the argument between these two positions produces the truth, the synthesis. Okay. You see this in science, where you have to have a hypothesis and a null hypothesis. Null hypothesis. It's opposite. That if this happens, then this is true. If this happens, then it absolutely isn't true. That's your null hypothesis. Okay. And we see this in our courts, where we have the prosecutor and the defense attorney who argue back and forth, and hopefully the jury and the judge come to a synthesis of what the truth is between these two opposing positions. Okay. Marx is going to use this and apply it to history. And he says that throughout history, there's always a struggle between those who have the stuff, the material, and those who don't have it. And they argue back and forth until there is a merger of the two and creates a new haves class. And he says that's how you move through history. Now, quite frankly, his history is not great. Okay, he makes some real historical errors, some of which I'll point out as we go. Now, he sees the first society as proto-communism. And then the next one is a slave society. And he uses Rome for this. And he says you have the patricians and the plebeians and the haves and the have-nots. And they're going to argue back and forth. Now, that argument back and forth between patricians and plebeians is a little bit misleading, though. Because the plebeians were, in fact, in Rome, citizens of Rome. They were not just Joe Blow and they were not slaves. They had rights. They owned property in Rome by and large. We are not talking about the bottom of the social scale. That would be slaves. Okay. But don't confuse Marx with facts. Okay. He's not a great historian. He says the argument between them eventually produces a feudal, F-E-U-D-A-L, feudal society. Okay. So the first society is the slave society. And you've got patricians, plebeians, and then their synthesis will create the lords, which is the haves class of the next society, which is the feudal society. Then the feudal society, the lords argue with the peasants or the serfs. And they argue back and forth until you create the bourgeoisie. He is conveniently skipping over a lot of stuff, like, oh, a middle class, which he sees as the new owners. Now, the problem is with this, is that he's missing the fact that the lords, the aristocracy doesn't go away. You still get the bourgeoisie who are owning production, some of whom are these guys, some of whom are new guys, and you still have a work. That there are three that are operating, not just two. Once again, he misses stuff and he misses nuance. The bourgeoisie he sees as the new industrial society, and the next phase is the industrial society. Okay. On that side, you have the bourgeoisie, who are the owners of the factories. He is not using bourgeoisie in the way the French do in the French Revolution. Or prior to the French Revolution. Okay, that's not what he means here. He's not talking about bankers and lawyers. He's talking about the owners of the factories. And the proletariat are the people who work in the factories, the working class. Now, he's pulled the proletariat from ancient Rome. And in Rome, it does have a reference to a specific group of people in Rome who were workers, okay? They were also freemen. They were not the lowest of things. There were actually a couple of guys lower than them. Once again, don't tell it that. Now, put a star here, because if you find a theorist that you're reading, somebody who's reading, who's talking about bourgeoisie or proletariat, and they're not, with bourgeoisie, they're not talking about pre-revolutionary France. If they're not talking about pre-revolutionary France and they're talking about bourgeoisie, you've got a Marxist writing, okay? And the same is true about the proletariat. Now, here's where things get interesting in his theory, because he doesn't see these guys merging again. Now, he's not a guy who believes he's going to know about the computer revolution, obviously, and some things that are going to change the economy significantly. But he says these two guys cannot merge. There's going to be too much distance. The misery of the proletariat is going to be too great. And so at that point, instead of another merging, you're going to get inevitable world revolution. Now, notice what he says. It's going to happen. He also says it's going to be worldwide and not national, because he doesn't believe in nations, okay? And from there, we'll go to a dictatorship of the proletariat, where the proletariats are going to be the dictators for a short time, at least, until everybody gets used to having no private property at all and sharing everything alike again. And the only way you can do that is with force. Okay. And then after that, we'll get a workers' utopia where everybody shares everything in common. Marx is an idealist. Okay. He is very much an idealist. He believes in that human nature. He's kind of this odd idea that he believes the worst of the haves, but the best of the have-nots, as if the have-nots never commit any atrocities themselves. Okay. Now, here's the problem. Anybody who's ever tried to implement his theory gets stuck in the dictatorship of the proletariat, and they never get out. And quite frankly, his theory as it is, isn't actually going to wind up being workable. Now, his political ideology is going to be merged and shifted before it's actually implemented anywhere. He's also incorrect about where the revolution is going to occur. He thinks the revolution is going to be in Germany or in Britain first, and he's wrong. Because where you get Marxist governments that actually are tried are in places where industrialism is not across the entirety of the country. The first kind of shifting of his theory is done by Vladimir Ilyich Lenin, who I talk more about in the Russian Revolution lecture. That's a printed lecture for next week. And the revolution is accomplished by a small core of revolutionaries. Lenin doesn't think you need mass revolution, which is what, quite frankly, Marx says is going to happen, okay? Lenin says, nah, you can do this with a small core of revolutionaries and pull everybody else along later. this is not what Marx says, but he's going to shift it. And we call all this Marxist-Leninism, okay? Mao Zedong, okay? Mao Zedong is going to adapt Marxism to peasants. And I was going to annotate this, but I can't, so hold on one second. Mao Zedong is going to be the leader of the Communist Revolution in China. He'll begin his work in the early portion of the 20th century and be successful in creating Communist China eventually in 1949. By the way, the reason we call it Maoist is because in Asian cultures, you write the last name first, okay? Your family name, your surname comes before your individual name, which is very indicative of Chinese culture, which is the reason why we call it Maoist and not Zedongist, okay? That would be very improper. Maoist thought, Mao has a problem in bringing communism to China because he doesn't have any industrial class for the most part. He has peasants. He has rural society. And so he adapts Marxism to, in fact, a peasant society and adapts it that way. Marx doesn't actually like peasants. He thinks they're stupid. He kind of says that several times. Now, there are a lot of other isms, and I'm going to leave Marxism there. We'll hit it again as we look at the Russian Revolution next week. Positive and progressivism argue that society was getting better, and the idea of science and education is very critical to this, and they're going to see a man progressing towards greater liberty, greater understanding, and greater humanity, if you will. Auguste Comte is going to be one of the main theorists of this. These guys are going to be very prominent in kind of the legislative reforms that you see in the United States and some in even Great Britain. You also have feminism. Now, the song that you're hearing is Helen Reddy and is the theme song of liberation movement in the 1960s and 1970s. Feminism was often competing and sometimes even combined with socialism. Marx wanted to get rid of the family. That's something that many feminists latch onto. The socialists, on the other hand, often argued with feminists. Feminists are going to argue that male patriarchy and male dominance is the basic problem. But the socialists are going to say that capitalism and economics are the problem, not the other way around. I'm waiting for the video feed to get the catch up. Okay. There were a lot of what's going to happen with feminism is going to be connected with the idea of getting the vote. And we see two different groups are going to be part of this. The suffragists and the suffragettes, okay? These are two different groups. Both want the vote for women. Suffragists were often middle class women, sometimes working class, sometimes aristocratic, but they simply wanted women to get the votes. They wanted to use legislative means and other things to exact change. Suffragettes were willing to use violent protest, not just marches, but setting things on fire and other things to, in fact, create change and to get the vote. These that you see here are a little bit of both. What you see here are more suffragists who are marching and protest marching for suffrage. You'll get that from suffragists and suffragettes. This over here is more about the suffragettes, and this is very much something what you see in England. What happens is that you would have these suffragettes who would chain themselves to the prime minister's carriage. They would set the prime minister's carriage on fire. They would do other violent acts, and then they would get arrested. Okay. Now, these are middle-class women who would get arrested, and then when they got into prison, would go on a hunger strike to protest the system that has now arrested them. The governors of prisons were kind of at a loss, so they would do these forced feedings of women that you see here. which went over very, very badly. You can see how this is being used here. This is a modern inquisition of what they're doing by a liberal government who's supposed to be interested in freedom. And this is what we're doing to people who are advocating more freedom. So eventually in England, they create what is known as the Cat and Mouse Act. The Cat and Mouse Act actually allowed for women who got too sick from doing hunger strikes to be released. And then once they got out and started eating again and were fine, then they would rearrest them. This didn't work very well either. And it's really beginning to get to much of a crisis when, in fact, the First World War comes. Suffrage is going to be given to women in different ways at different times and different places. The first country to give women the right to vote is New Zealand. And that fits in with what tends to happen. First state in the United States that gives women the right to vote is in about 1890, and that's going to be Wyoming. Wyoming and New Zealand are both frontier areas. In frontier areas, women tend to do better. Women in the Middle Ages do better than women in the Renaissance do. Simply because the more regulations, the more you cut women out of access to economic opportunity in the Renaissance. And that's what's come to a crisis here in a lot of ways. Britain will give women the right to vote in 1918 and 1928. And what the difference in those 2 years is the politicians are not very certain what giving the women the right to vote is going to do. So they kind of do it in a phased process. In 1918, women who held property and who were over 30 could vote. After 1928, they give it to all women who are over the voting age, okay? Part of what they find, though, is when they give women the right to vote, it doesn't actually create a separate voting block. Even though they're about to double the size of the electorate, what it winds up being is that most women voted the way either their fathers or their brothers or their husbands did. It doubles the vote. It doesn't actually create this large group of women who don't vote, who vote vastly differently from the rest of the society. It just kind of doubled both halves. Even now, we see that men and women who are in the same family groups tend to vote similarly, unless they're rebelling against one side or the other. Okay, and we'll sometimes see generational differences more than we will gender ones, okay? Now, the United States gives women the right to vote in 1920. Britain and U.S. will be the first of the Western democracies to do so. Switzerland and Sweden both won't give women the right to vote until 1970, and France won't do it until 1944. Because while you're going to have this agitation for women's rights in the 19th century, it's not going to come to fruition until the 20th. You see a lot of arguing and discussions about this in the 19th century. The term feminism that deals with women having equal rights as men is coined by a newspaper that actually wrote about these sorts of things in 1896. You're going to get other developments in the 20th century that add to what is the current ideology of some feminists. And there's a lots of divides in feminists. I'm not going into the various different waves of feminism. And there's a lot of arguments with socialism about who is right. The socialists and the feminists do not really get along. That was one of the interesting things about the run for president in 2016 on the Democratic side. And we also saw that even when Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton were vying for the Democratic nomination, that you're getting Hillary representing more of the feminist wing of the party, where you get the socialist wing more with, certainly with Bernie Sanders, and even to a degree with Barack Obama. And so that these two groups, while they look like they have a lot in common, actually diverge on some rather key issues about what's most important. And that's something that you see even in the 19th century. The idea that women are other and are second class is going to be very much emphasized by Simone de Beauvoir in 1949. She's going to talk about women also, and she's going to argue that somehow sex is not biological. And that gender is more the issue. The gender idea is going to come in very, very clearly in the 1970s, that this is a constructed idea, whereas sex is just biological organisms. And Sexual Politics by Kate Millay talks about how the personal is political. And in Millay's work is going to be much more prominent in modern feminism than many of the ideas of the 19th century. Marx's ideas and Engels' ideas about the abolition of the family somehow being capitalist oppression, which is really, really interesting considering the family predates capitalism, is going to be something that's going to be picked up by authors like Millay and Beauvoir. I'm going to move from these and to some other isms. The last that I want to deal with today is going to be the ism that's going to come with science, and that's going to be social Darwinism. Now, social Darwinism is not the science. It's going to be the social movement that's built on the science. The science begins with Charles Darwin. Charles Darwin's Origin of the Species is published in 1859, and where he begins to talk about and pursue his theories of evolution and about the evolution of organisms and that they're not created immutable by creation. And he sees that how question of adaptations of organisms adapting themselves. Now, he's going to publish this in 1859. There are some gaps. He does not know about genetic mutations. He's going to believe that you can inherit adapted characteristics. In other words, education being inherited. Education has to be relearned with each generation. But don't tell Darwin that, okay? Because he's going to see characteristics, physical characteristics like developing something, a skill, be something that you can inherit. And I'm really oversimplifying because I got to get onto something else. Darwin's theories are written after his scientific travels. He works on this for 20 years, but he's never completely satisfied with the Origin of the Species. He keeps revising it and revising it and revising it. Eventually, he's going to write The Descent of Man in 1871, and this is the one where he talks about the concept of human evolution and tries to theorize the human evolution through various stages from ape to human. He's missing several pieces in this, and he makes a couple of jumps that those who studied skulls were not entirely happy with. He argues for nature selecting those that are, once again, the best to survive, but he doesn't say survival of the fittest. That's going to come a little later. And he talks about, like I said, inheritance of acquired characteristics, which scientists now say is not really possible. You have to do genetic mutations instead. His ideas are going to be picked up by a social theorist by the name of Herbert Spencer. Now, Herbert Spencer is not a guy you know much anymore, but he's going to be critical to developing the social theories that are going to be prominent in the 19th century and throughout the early 20th century based on Darwin's ideologies. There's Herbert. He coins the term survival of the fittest to kind of sum up a lot of what Darwin is saying. And he plies this concept of survival of the fittest, not between various species of animals, but to society as a whole. And that society is moving forward to this final evolution, and only the fittest in society should be allowed to survive. This kind of idea is going to compete with ideas about taking care of people who are less fortunate. You're going to have the socialists who don't agree with the Darwinists or the Spencerites, and they compete with one another for resources. You're going to also have the religious ideologists. You're going to say, no, we need to be charitable towards fellow man, who are going to be arguing with, in fact, those who are going to support Spencer. I'm trying to pause my recording really, really fast, and it's not letting. While Spencer applied this society towards a societal evolution, he also is going to apply this eventually, as are his followers, to various groups of humans. And this is where racism is going to get some sort of scientific foundation out of this. It's not sound at all, but there are going to be those who follow this, once again, with a lot of religious-like devotion. His idea is going to become very, very popular by the 1904 World's Fair. It's going to be held in St. Louis. And at St. Louis, there is an anthropology exhibit, which in fact is going to define all the races of the world and rank them amongst the fittest of them, the most superior, the most evolved. Yes, there's a ton of racism involved in all of this. And no ands, ifs, buts, or maybes on this. You can see this here. This is the placard that actually was kind of the advertising postcard for the anthropology exhibit. And you see them, we're going to go from all of the various ones here. And there's the Arab, and there's the Chinaman, and there's the Turk, and there's the Arab. The Japanese is up here. And then we have another one that before we, and the Russian before we move to the Caucasian. We would also have this particular lovely piece that was at the 1904 World's Fair. And some people are born to be a burden on the West. And this, and we have these different things is very few person. And we've got these different ones. And the people who are born more frequently are going to be the ones who are more burdensome on society. We need the people who are born up here, okay? And these flashing lights, and we're going to learn about heredity so that we can correct these problems in society and not create the people who are more burdensome. And you can see how this attitude is going to be applied to, quite frankly, people with any sort of disability or who are simply of a different race. One of the things that's going to be part of this is the eugenics movement, which is going to be the science of racism, which is going to be popular at universities and is going to used to justify a lot of racial profiling in these. The eugenics movement is going to have a lot of followers. Like I said, it's going to be very popular at universities. You're going to get a eugenics department at Harvard, at Yale, and they're going to actually put forth theories about how different races evolve. And while this is very, very difficult to even talk about because it makes your stomach turn, and it does certainly for me, this is the reality of the early 19th century. The early 20th century and the late 19th century. This is everywhere. Spencer is lauded. He goes on speaking engagement tours. They all think he's brilliant. Okay. International fairs are going to be used this way. And the ideas of social Darwinism and eugenics are going to be used to justify imperialism and unfortunately are going to underlie a lot of the theories of Nazi Germany and the genocide policies that they're going to perpetrate, not just the extermination of the Jews, but the exterminations of anybody who's disabled, who gets sick too often. Any of these people would just simply disappear in Nazi Germany because they were preventing them reaching this perfect end that Spencer had talked about and has been kind of sunk into the fabric, not just in the United States, but also all over Europe and certainly in Germany. It's used to justify imperialism. Rudyard Kipling's The White Man's Burden, which is a poem that's about how to that is written to try and get the United States to come and be involved in worldwide imperialism to bring the lesser races. Make certain that you understand that's not what I mean. What I believe, but that's the idea of the time, that these lesser quote-unquote races who had not evolved much need to be drug up to the level of everybody else. And so that's just the justification for imperialism. It's the justification that's there certainly at the 1884 Berlin Conference, when the European powers will simply divide up the map of Africa in like they're playing a game of Risk, except for this one is real. Okay, all of these are part of this concept of social Darwinism that's going to be very prevalent. The isms are not just political, and that's the thing to kind of remember in all of this, is that the isms are going to be very much a part of everyday life. They're going to involve science, they're going to involve culture, they're going to involve political ideologies, they're going to involve intellectual ideologies. This is why sometimes we refer to them as secular creeds. is simply because they're going to be followed with religious like devotion. I'll talk to you on the next one. I hope this finds you well. And if you're having any sort of issues, please let me know.